I thank the Consortium for the opportunity of being part of this webinar. So I'm speaking to you as one of many colleagues at University of Newcastle who are keen to share experience on how to best educate others about the implications of climate change for health and healthcare. I'll be presenting about the collaborations we're a part of, our current educational programs which feature climate change, and how we're using resources and networks to increase coverage of these topics in our other curricula. So next slide, please. So I'd firstly like to tell you about the medical schools in Australia and New Zealand having come together to address the need to educate medical students about climate change and health. This has been done under the auspices of the Medical Deans Australia New Zealand organisation, with the working group established by the Medical Education Collaboration Committee. I acknowledge the vision of Professor Lynn Madden and also Professor Michelle McLean, who's presenting today, in initiating this process, and for the work of all the other members of the group, which includes student representatives from both countries. This is what you're seeing now is the title slide from a conference presentation at the Australian New Zealand Association of Health Professional Educators, and it shows the members of the group as at July of this year. So next slide, thank you. So as we described in an article in the Medical Journal of Australia, we've taken a systems approach working across medical programs in our countries. We've felt that a systems approach is needed due to the urgency of the problem and the fact that change in curricula is needed at scale. So to quote Professor Madden at that recent presentation, isolated pockets of excellence are not a solution to this existential threat. Thank you, next slide. So what are the tasks of the working group? So I'll firstly quote our terms of reference. Now the first part of that is to develop learning objectives, curricula, and learning resources to ensure that medical graduates are competent, firstly, to deal with anticipated adverse health consequences of climate change, to promote health co-benefits of actions to address climate change, and to be role models and change agents for mitigation and adaptation actions. So the five broad areas before you were determined to be what should be covered following a review of the literature, teaching experience of the members of the group, and courses developed, some of which have been developed by students for their peers, which is wonderful. Thank you, next slide. A second part of the terms of reference relates to the working group recommending to the medical dean's executives whether accreditation standards for medical schools should address the health implications of climate change. So why have we focused on accreditation? Again, we believe that this change needs to occur at fast pace and also across all the medical programs in our two countries. So including these concepts into accreditation standards, which are overseen by the Australian Medical Council, is a systematic way to create change in a regulated profession. So the Australian Medical Council's standards comprise graduate outcome statements, which are grouped into these domains, which you see before you. The current AMC graduate outcome statements by our group have been mapped against the five areas which you saw in the previous slide to determine whether these graduate outcome statements are sufficient currently as they're written, or if amendments or new changes are required to sufficiently address climate change. Thank you, next slide. So we've recommended changes in all four domains. The amendments that we've made represent modest changes to the statements, as you can see here. They're written in red as amendments, but in all there have been amendments to 10 graduate outcome statements. Four others were thought to also be relevant to climate change but don't require amendment. So next slide. The working group considers that this approach provides medical programs with the opportunities to encompass climate change and at the same time allowing the schools the scope to extend curricula, for example, to include planetary health as an overarching concept. So next slide. Out of the four domains, this third domain contains the largest number of amendments that we've recommended, and I've shown you there a selection of them. I haven't included in this presentation others in domain four in the interests of time. Now, I will point out here that these amendments that I'm showing you are recommendations from our working group. They are yet to feed into a formal review of accreditation by the of standards by the Australian Medical Council, and I'll discuss that when I talk about our further steps. Thank you. Next slide. So as you can see here, for each graduate outcome statement, we have suggested more detailed learning outcomes that we've drawn from the literature and which have been developed by our working group. There are others that I haven't listed here, which specifically relate to climate change, and I'll just read out a selection of them. In the domain of clinical practice, an example of a learning objective would be to prevent, diagnose and treat adverse health effects attributed to climate change and environmental causes. An example relating to professionalism and leadership is to identify a way to improve the sustainability of healthcare system by decreasing carbon footprint through individual practice, health service management, and design of care systems. Thank you, next slide. So our next step in the working group is to inform accreditation standards at the next opportunity of the Australian Medical Council Accreditation Review. Now, we have already distributed all of these learning objectives and recommendations for changes to accreditation standards to all of the medical programs in Australia and New Zealand. So the members of our team will be working with programs individually on implementation and also sharing resources and helping programs to develop and implement resources which are useful for their local circumstances. Thirdly, our team sees the need to measure and monitor the effect of how these learning objectives and related content are being delivered. We see a need to share what we're doing in medical education with other professions, and we have plans to distribute this information and to discuss with other programs and other professions what we're doing. And finally, to publish our work in journals and to discuss at future ANSIPI meetings and other international forums, which I know Michelle will be talking about shortly. Thank you, next slide. So I'll move now to the current teaching at the University of Newcastle. So for many years now, we've actually had a course on social and ecosystem health, which is a core course of the Masters of Public Health. So all students doing the Masters of Public Health will study this content. We have 76 students enrolled in this course in 2019. So early in the semester, basic concepts relating to climate change are covered. Later in the semester, in module 5 out of 6, more advanced concepts are talked about in terms of impacts on human health, how humans can adapt and what health systems can do to help them with that, including co-benefits, a discussion of different pathways through which climate change affects health, and for a more detailed example, to talk about how practices in urban and house design affect population health. Thank you, next slide. Assessment for this course includes during the semester an online task where students research different models of eco-cities and what principles from which they've learnt in the course are applied in each of these cities, which they may research around the world. And then finally, towards the end of the semester, a group-based project, which is an equity-focused health impact assessment of a program or policy plan. So the central aim there is to consider how a proposal impacts differently on different groups. And as is written there on the slide, many of these projects are based on climate-related policies and programs. Thank you. Next slide. A recent addition to the teaching in this particular course relates to coping with climate change distress. To reflect on past teaching, whether that's in optional advocacy sessions or in more formal climate change content, the teaching tends to involve descriptions of threats to health, vulnerable populations, how health services will struggle, and then we'll find that we'll perhaps, to compensate for the concern that we're engendering, we'll shift to a solutions approach. And sometimes, and that's in the hope of restoring some sort of balance. But this year we decided to pause in our face-to-face sessions, and which are also recorded, for a dedicated time to reflect amongst the group about the thoughts and emotions that are evoked by this sort of concerning content. This seemed to be quite cathartic for the group and very much appreciated. And this is in line with the principles of importance of acknowledging painful feelings. We then moved on to practical suggestions from within the group and also referring to fantastic resources, as one that I've listed here as an example from the Australian Psychological Society. And I've just talked here about the very the section titles, really, and there's much more detail in this resource. But an example of behavioural strategy might be to maintain your healthy work-life balance with regular exercise, but also to see reducing your own carbon footprint as a coping mechanism in coping with distress. Relational strategies might include benefiting from talking with friends and other supports about their perspectives on our distress, and that can often be helpful. A cognitive strategy might be, dropping the judgmental approach with others, but also with ourselves. Often that can be associated with guilt about not doing enough. And emotional coping strategies would include acknowledging our feelings about this, validating and reflecting on the fact that other people are feeling the same. Thank you. Next slide. And so our attention will now turn to building content across our undergraduate medical program, which is a sequential Bachelor of Medical Science and Doctor of Medicine delivered over 5 years between two universities, the University of Newcastle and the University of New England, which is a 4 hours drive away from us. Thank you. Next slide. The program evolves from predominantly problem-based learning through case-based learning to more formal clinical rotations and a research project. There are longitudinal themes, and you can see there that health, society, environment is one of those themes. And our team that we've assembled include public health researchers and educators, health behaviour science educators, and we have an Indigenous medical education academic and a general practitioner. Thank you. Next slide. Our approach is to engage with researchers and educators who are active in the field of climate change, and also to make use of external forums, such as one recently that was convened by a junior doctor who'd been attending advocacy sessions that the university had also held. It was well attended by experts and interested parties with a wide range of backgrounds, who some of which indicated interest and willingness to participate in education in the medical program. Thank you. Next slide. Here's an example of incorporating some of the medical dean's learning objectives into an existing 6-week community placement component. There's already a focus in this on factors that prevent equitable access to healthcare. So this is a chance to include content on the environmental determinants of health, utilising the content of teaching in our master's programs that's already existing, experts in our networks, and also the shared resources, including the fantastic online help provided by this global consortium. Thank you. Last slide. We'll also be guided by frameworks such as this one, which a team of us, including colleagues in Melbourne, developed and published in Medical Teacher. And I just point out those ones in red are what we're applying in this particular clinical placement assessment, in that we're priming students to be aware of the environmental determinants of health and how they're changing. And the assessment will be a reflective presentation at the end of their rotation in which they focus on what factors, including climate change, affect health equity in their community. So with that, I'll thank you very much for listening, and I'll hand back over to my colleagues.
Thank you so much, Graeme. That was an excellent presentation. So right now, I'm just going to, we'll get right into our next presentation. So we'll have Drs. Michelle McLean and Kristen McKenzie-Shalders talk about their really exciting work at Bond University and beyond. So Michelle has been doing amazing work to develop and support climate and health education at many different levels. And I know that you guys can see this box. I'm gonna try and keep it to the side just for right now. So she's been doing work at many different levels, including at the faculty, institutional, national, and global levels. And we're excited to hear her talk more about that. Kristen has been doing really interesting work with dietetics, both at her university and nationally. So I'm going to turn it right over to you, Michelle, and please get started whenever you're ready.
Thank you for the invitation, Brittany. It's a pleasure to be here to share our experiences. So as Brittany said, I'll do probably the first 10 minutes and then I'll turn over to Kristen, who's in it with Brittany in the States. So this is the Bond experience. So if you could pass me the next slide, please. Thank you. Thank you, Graeme, for setting the scene in terms of the medical dean. So I kind of call it, I just go MDAN. So when I say MDANs, that's what I mean, the medical deans of Australia and New Zealand. So before we even started with that, I switched one of the sessions that I'd put in for, that had been in place for about 2 or 3 years in global health. There was no parasitology in the curriculum. So I introduced parasitology and looked at the different regions of the world, and students did a poster, and then we had a little conference. And my concern around climate change was increasing, and so I put this forward to the curriculum and said, I'm going to switch this into a planetary health experience for the students. And so in 2017, this is how I developed it, a series of sessions. So we started with a PBL presentation, the PBL group presentations, introducing planetary health, global health, and looking at some of the major issues. And SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals, were included in that. The PowerPoints then became resources for the cohort. We then did a workshop where students identified past, current, and future global issues. And while a few, like sort of 2017, 16, climate change was the future, the more recent ones, it's current. So now it's a current problem and obviously a future problem. This switched assignment was used the Sustainable Development Goals as the background, the framework. I chose standard SDG 13, which is climate action. And I said to the students, take one other and identify an issue. They submitted a proposal within a rubric around what this issue was and how they intended to address it. Once I had that had been approved, they then had a couple of weeks to develop a product. And these products have been amazing. Information brochures, videos, letters to environments and health ministers, websites, for instance, and those are shared with other students. Then the best products are showcased at a small conference. We decide these are the top 6 or 8, and the students then do a short presentation, the groups, and the students vote for the people's choice. And there's also an academic award. Next slide, please. So have we integrated the medical deans or MEDANs learning outcomes into our program, which is an MD? So we have mapped all of the endorsed medical deans' graduate outcome statements and learning objectives. And I have to just say that some of those graduate outcome statements are the consortium statements. We looked at the literature, as Graeme said, and some of those have framed that. We are now working, myself and my colleague who's the curriculum lead, Joe Bishop, working with the theme lead, scholar and scientist, practitioner, health advocate and professional, to integrate these graduate outcome statements and the learning objectives into the throughout the curriculum. So taking environmental history, for example, when the exacerbations of asthma, diarrhea is another example, and then in our five-year program, year three is probably a good year to integrate what is the cost of these of investigations and looking at that from a sustainability perspective. Thank you. Next slide. So in terms of our program, rather than just concentrate on climate change, I've taken a broader view and looking at global environmental changes. So climate change is just one of them. But in this Frumkin and Haynes article on NCDs and global environmental changes, there's a whole lot of threats to our environment and then obviously to health. And so we look at food, nutrition, but biodiversity loss and air pollution, air and water pollution. So it sort of broadens a little bit into that environment, those environmental perspectives. Thank you. Next slide. Today, this is what we've done to integrate. So in year one, I introduced the Sustainable Development Goals and the concept of environmental sustainability in healthcare. And as I've just described, the big year two project or assignment is the scene is set by a PBL case, a problem-based learning case, malaria in the Solomon Islands, Kira Kira Hospital. About a third of our students do their international placement there. So it kind of sets the scene in year two for them to know where they're going. And this starts a conversation in global and planetary health. I've also just recently adapted the outcomes, the rubric for the MD capstone project, which will include the Kira Kira, but they also go to South Africa and to some remote indigenous communities and to India, so that the SDGs are within that framework. So in their reflective report, they're looking at the Sustainable Development Goals. And for the first time this year, in the MD professional projects, which have traditionally been educational, I've introduced a planetary health stream, and I've had one student who has taken that, and she will be developing some short videos for the first year students on the Sustainable Development Goals, taking some of the key ones that are important locally in the region. Next slide, please. There is also a Masters of Healthcare Innovation, which will start in January next year. And I've offered an elective 12-week course in planetary health. And these some of the topics that are included are the SDGs, so from Millennium Development Goals to the Sustainable Development Goals, global environmental changes, food security, sustainable healthcare, because health has a big footprint. In Australia, it's about 7% carbon emissions, which is about 2.5 times more than what the UK carbon footprint is. And then equity, we spend a fair bit of time on equity and ethics relating to environmental issues. And then the last 2 weeks are looking at what solutions are out there, what have people already done, and this incorporates design and systems thinking. Next slide, please. So in terms of the Bond University and our faculty, Bond University has a sustainability committee. And we have semester seminars that we run for the whole university. Kristen did one recently on food stewardship, and the response was overwhelming. We had to bring in extra chairs because so many people were interested. The next one will be in a couple of weeks, and it will be looking at sustainable development goals because it fits into the third bullet item here, July 2019. Bond University became a signatory to the Sustainable Development Goals. So at centrally, they're working at how can we reduce our environmental footprint. In April this year, I submitted a proposal for a faculty environmental sustainability committee. It's got traction, and we had our first meeting in October. It covers all our major activities, procurement, travel, research, learning and teaching. And so we each have portfolios and we're looking at working in identifying gaps. What is it we're doing well? What are we not doing well? Where can we move forward? And then submitting those recommendations. Food wastage, plastic and energy are big issues for us. Next slide, please. So where to from here? So as Graeme has already said, the Medical Dean's working group, nationally we're developing a resource repository for learning and teaching activities so that we can share across the more than 20 universities in Australia and New Zealand, medical faculties. We're also looking to develop an inventory of resources for faculty upskilling, and the consortium resources are an invaluable repository in this regard. In terms of Bond University, there's ongoing medical program integration of climate change and global environmental changes. And then we have to look at how do we integrate the sustainable development goals across all our faculty programs, because thus far it's really only med and then the work that Kristen is doing in dietetics. In terms of faculty development, this has to happen across all nationally, internationally, institutionally, and particularly looking at interprofessional education, because it's not just our domain, the med domain, it's not just nursing, it's got to happen across domains. And the exciting news is in terms of the Glasgow 2020 conference, the AME conference, Association for Medical Education in Europe, I contacted Professor Ron Harden just before the Vienna one and said, Glasgow is one of the most sustainable cities in the UK. And so we have to really be thinking about sustainable healthcare, sustainability, but healthcare education. And the UK, for me, is leading in terms of healthcare education. Their Tomorrow's Doctor has a graduate outcome that asks all medical schools to integrate climate change and sustainability into their programs by the summer of 2020, which coincides with Glasgow 2020. So for suggesting that, I was invited to chair the planning group, which we've already started. Next slide, please. Next slide. So the advice, my final slide here, the advice, because it's tough having to fly the sustainability flag. You get a bit of flack from a couple of sides. You just continue to do it. And it's necessary to change perceptions, and it is happening. You can expect resistance. I'm sure most of you have already experienced that, but you keep on going, your voice will be heard. And this is just a little impromptu feedback that I got. It was World Teachers Day a week or two ago, and our Office of Learning and Teaching put out little boxes with these cards just for students to say thank you. And you can see, thank you for your unending work and passion for planetary health. So if it's about role modeling good practice and role modeling sustainability, at least I've made an impression on one person. I think that's my last slide, Brittany, and it passes over to Kristen. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing all of this information. I will just hand it right over to Kristen right now. So go ahead, Kristen.
Sure, thank you for the opportunity to talk and also to Michelle for sharing your 15 minutes with me. I've kept my presentation mostly to pictures for two reasons. One is to show off how beautiful the Gold Coast is, where Bond University is, so it might encourage people to visit. And the other is so I could sort of change what I was going to talk about, depending how long Michelle went and how much time I have. But in terms of our Master of Nutrition and Dietetic Practice program at Bond, it's a two-year degree, and our cohorts start in May each year. It's an AQF, which is Australian Qualifications Framework Level 9 Master's degree, which it's the only dietetics course of its kind in Australia that has a significant research component. So all of our students do at least a 6-month full-time research project, as well as their coursework that accredits them as accredited practicing dietitian in Australia and regionally. The exciting thing is that we're also going through a process of foreign dietetic equivalent ASCEND accreditation so that our graduates have a pathway to become an RD in the USA. And we've got our site visit for that in the new year. But yeah, early in that process and the only course in a dietetics course in Australia with that. Next slide, thank you. So some of the challenges for incorporating sustainability into our curriculum. In Australia, we have limited accreditation requirement for its inclusion. The current DAA competencies have no mention of environmental sustainability. However, the ones that preceded them did up until 2015. So unfortunately, we've gone backwards in that area. However, of course, because we're going for ASCEND accreditation, there is some environmental sustainability components to that. As we are an accredited degree for dietetic health profession, there's a very heavy workload for our students and competing priorities. And also because we have a very strong research focus, that takes up a lot of time as well. As well as this, there's not a clear identified scope of practice for dietitians working in environmental sustainability. I'm lucky enough to be part of the Food and Environment Committee that advocates to and works directly with DAA on the area of environmental sustainability. And we meet regularly and work closely with DAA on this space. We've actually now just got a scope of practice document that's out for feedback from the dietetics members in Australia to have more clear scope of practice for dietitians in Australia. The other challenge for us is that environmental sustainability is not captured in our current national food guide, except as an appendix that's very much hidden away and hard to find unless you go directly looking for it. And I won't talk to this too much, but there is a huge shift in increasing focus in this area and internationally. And this is important in shifting our focus of incorporating more environmental sustainability. Australia itself has signed the Paris Agreement and the Sustainable Development Goals. And so this is trickling down in terms of some of the legislation and direction that a lot of the organisations we're working with falling under. So some of our solutions to this issue, one of those, and you can see me there in front of some of our students, is to identify champions or change makers, and I'm trying to be one of those, and also identifying students that want to be in this space or have dialogue around this space. And also incorporate an early focus on environmental sustainability. So all of our students do a one-day retreat in their second week of starting the program, and we go to a range of places. You can see on the left there the picture with the cow. That's on a working farm that uses organic principles. So we teach them a range of things, the paddock-to-plate principles and organic farming principles. Up the top left-hand side there, you can see the students at a place called Mudbrick Health Herb Farm, which is a locally owned farm near our university that also ships organic herbs around Australia. And it's a very successful family business, so sort of teaching them about that. And we also do a food miles activity and know your farmer activity. We take our students, and you can see some pictures down the bottom, to Mwillimbah Farmers Market. Mwillimbah is in the Byron Bay Shire, beautiful volcanic soil, and they manage to source a huge range of produce from within a 200 kilometre radius. They have a few things that come from further, such as Stanthorpe apples, which is about 350 km, but our students compare things like pricing, quality, understanding where that food has come from, the food miles, and to a local supermarket, Woolworths, you can see there. We also have a range of assessments that we incorporate environmental sustainability in. On the top left-hand side, you can see our students do a product development activity where they need to come up with a niche food product. And part of that is that they have to understand or demonstrate their knowledge of the food standards code, nutritional composition, and so on. But we've got an environmental sustainability criteria, and a lot of our students opt to look at environmental principles in those products that they develop. You can also see some other pictures there. The one on the top is our current cohort of students at Guanabara Indigenous Land, which is a local Indigenous community that does a lot of regeneration work. And so our students have gone there, and you can see us planting some native trees. But as well as that, there's that one about Indigenous land. There's a lot of bush tucker or local foods. And so we're, you can see it's picking some native blueberries and so on. And that's in line with some of the work by Bruce Pascoe in Australia around Indigenous agriculture. And and the understanding that while there's only a small proportion of Australia that is able to be traditionally farmed, a larger proportion can be farmed if you're using Indigenous foods. And we also teach nutrition and food science, which you can see down the bottom there. So we have, we try and practice what we preach in terms of doing recycling and those types of things in our food cooking classes. Next slide. So we also aim to incorporate environmental sustainability into our placements and research projects. All of our students, I'm the food service domain lead at Bond University, and I'm concerned with overseeing food service, which is the provision of food on scale, and all of our students do a 6-week full-time placement. And some of these have been related to environmental sustainability. And you can see that I presented that was this year up on the top left-hand side at our Queensland Food Services Statewide Network Conference on a scoping project that we did on environmental sustainability in one of our large hospitals. And one of the good things about that is that we've already got another project that's come from that presentation that we're doing at our largest Queensland hospital, with our students working with their food service on the environmental sustainability of that food service. So very exciting that we're starting to get some leverage there. So related to that last slide, just very quickly, we're also having a range of research projects around environmental sustainability, and we've got some of our first students that have started to take those up, and like Michelle, I'm offering those every year. We're aiming to incorporate environmental sustainability into our operations. You can see on the left there, we're planting, this is a composter herb farm, and it's a worm farm and herb pot in one, and that's manufactured locally in Burleigh Heads on the Gold Coast, and having a lot of dialogue around this area. So on the right-hand side, our students are there with Ned Wales, who's from our Faculty of Building and Design, and he's doing a lot of work in the area of environmental sustainability as well. So we've got some cross collaborative things going. Also working with Mark Spence from our business school, who has that sort of consumer angle of environmental sustainability. So we still have a very long way to go, and this is very much in its infancy. And I see increased urgency for us to continue to advocate with DAA in terms of getting more of a systematic approach to this for our discipline. And I'm personally looking to do a lot more applied research and engage our students in that process and get more PhD and master students along that line. But I'll finish there.
Thank you so much. And we are going to move right into our next presentation here. So Dr. Yang, are you there? Dr. Zhang?
Yes, I am.
Wonderful.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. And I'm just loading our your presentation here. So just give me one moment. Okay. Go ahead whenever you're ready.
Hello, this is Ying from Sydney. Thank you for inviting me to talk about our climate health curricula. I will give a brief overview about teaching climate and health at School of Public Health, University of Sydney. A bit of myself. I'm an epidemiologist, and my research has focused on climate change and public health for more than 15 years. Coordinator of the teaching on climate change and health in the school. Next, please. I will start with the initiatives at the University of Sydney and the leadership we have in incorporating climate and health curricula. Since the appointment of the world's first professor in planetary health, thanks to Tony Capon, there are several university-wide initiatives on planetary health, aiming to foster collaborations on the topic among different faculties and departments. And at the school level, the head of school, Professor Joe Negan, has a strong personal interest on environment and climate and health from his own research on social environmental determinants of health and health systems. So in addition, we also have academic staff who are really passionate about research on climate, environment, and health, which has been the key driver to the development of the curricula on the topic. I will discuss this with more details later on, but what I'm trying to say is that they all support, fully support the curriculum initiatives through a good understanding of the significance and the need, and recognizing the challenges and providing required resources in the process of developing new curricula. Next, please. And this table summarizes what is being offered at the school on climate and health. Just to give you a background of teaching at a school, we offer 7 postgraduate coursework degrees listed in the table. And currently we don't have any undergraduate students. So each year we have more than 500 new students enrolled in these degrees. We also have continuing part-time students as well. Climate change and health contents are still very young, as the other programs in our curriculum, but we have achieved a steady growth in recent years. As you can see in the table, MPH and Master of Global Health, the two major programs, have already incorporated climate health contents in their core and elective units. There's also a standalone MPH unit named Climate Change and Public Health, which is also available as an elective unit for all the other programs. For research degrees, there are research projects on climate change and health available for students. And this year we opened a new standalone online course for all students at the university, which is called Global Challenges, Planetary Health. So next slide, please. So now I'd like to give you some details about the contents of our teaching through two examples. And the first one is the standalone unit I just mentioned, a 6 credit point elective unit. To give you some ideas of the workload of the students, a full-time student is usually doing 24 credit points each semester. So this is intensive teaching with two days workshops available for both face-to-face and online students. We have more than 70 students each year. So it's very popular. And it's a real multidisciplinary teaching with guest lectures from law school, school of business, social science, health science, and medicine. A range of important topics relevant to climate health and sustainability are covered, such as international negotiations, injustice, IPCC report, which is delivered by a lead author of the IPCC report, and environmental economics, and so on. So this is a very successful model that we are very proud of. But I would also like to mention another not so successful example. We were trying to include climate health contents into the new core unit developed for the Master of Global Health, the skills for working in global health. There were two themes developed for tutorial discussions and exercise for this particular unit. And climate and health is one of the themes. And I'm one of the coordinators. We intended to use climate health as a case study to help students understand the complex of the context in global health. So they are able to critically analyze available evidence from different perspectives and demonstrate the skills required in policy advocacy, communication, engagement, etc. However, we found that it's very challenging for our students to be fully engaged in discussion. One of the reasons might be that this is the core unit offered the first, perhaps the first course in their study. And we have such a diverse cohort of students. Many of them don't even have a health background. And even for those who do have a health background, it's difficult for them to contribute to the discussion because they thought climate change is not a traditional health issue, which is true. And the link between climate and health needs some sort of prior knowledge to understand and then be able to participate in a discussion. So unfortunately, we will probably change the theme to another more traditional health topic so that it's relatively easier for the students to participate. But I would welcome your suggestions on how we could deal with such challenges in our teaching. So next, please. In terms of the process of developing the contents and the resources we used, I shall once again thank the passionate colleagues who worked with me to identify the gaps in our curricula and their willingness to include climate and health contents in their teaching. The support from the school is very important. The members of the school educational committee helped in reviewing the proposals and providing suggestions on assessment tasks and learning outcomes. I'm also thankful for the network and the collaborations from the university platforms to identify valuable guest lecturers who are all leading experts in the field. And this year, I have had 14 guest lecturers for the climate change and public health unit. So they are they're all committed to teaching. Some of them were on study leave and they came to the lecture room, and some adjusted their very tight schedule to fit in the workshop timetables. And it's all on a voluntary basis. So next slide, please. And that is part of the reason why this unit is so popular. And we always have a very high number of enrollment compared with other elective units. Here are some examples of the students' feedback. One student from the first cohort in 2016 addressed that, "I can't believe that this unit can only be offered from this year, but great efforts to make it happen." And you can see more feedback calls from this year's cohort that demonstrate the various motivations for students to do this unit. I'm grateful to be part of this course as my country is one of those severely affected by climate change. And for students in public health, we have more international students in recent years. And I have chosen to do the subject purely out of interest and wanting to learn more about the impact of climate change on health so I can be a better advocate. However, the responses from colleagues are different depending on the learning outcomes of their programs. But I think it's very promising to develop more initiatives based on my conversations with the program directors, especially for health policy and bioethics. We are planning to develop some new contents suitable for their students. So the next slide, please. And this is my last slide. I'm conscious about the time. I'd like to summarize what I have found challenging or helpful in promoting and developing climate health curricula. First of all, there is a real need from our students who want to know more about climate and health. And the question for us is how we can meet their need. Secondly, institutional leadership is essential and very important to make things happen. As you would agree with me that not all colleagues understand why there is a climate emergency and what we should do to respond. And we need innovations in our curriculum design due to the feature of the climate-related health problems we are facing. And students asked for solutions, more than the depressing impacts from climate change. To make the teaching contents more relevant to their own life and authentic assessment tasks and activities addressing the real world problems would be more likely to succeed. For example, I ask students to practice communication and climate change risks with their friends and families, and analyzing a health, heat health action plan in their cities. So last but not least, I can't address more how important it is to establish network for shared resources for our teaching. I have used the resources from the Global Climate and Health Alliance, partly because I'm a board member of it. And also I use the core competencies developed by GCC ISHE to cross-check our learning outcomes, which are all greatly appreciated. Next slide. That's all from me. Please feel free to contact me, and I have my email listed here. So if you have any questions or want to have more information, send me an email. And thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Dr. Zhang, and for all of your leadership in this area. And I just wanted to mention that Ying has, along with her colleagues, wrote the Medical Journal of Australia, Lands a Countdown on Health and Climate Change in 2018. And she just talked about all of the great work she's been doing at Sydney School of Public Health and has been coordinating the teaching on climate change and public health there since the course was first introduced in 2016. So really grateful for sharing all of your helpful information with the community.
Thank you. Since you mentioned that lesson countdown for Australia, I'd like to point out that the 2019 report is to be released next month, and we, Professor Lee Madden is one of the team members, and we actually added a textbook to highlight the importance to incorporate climate health contents in our medical curriculum. So watch this space.